Strong Money Australia, How to Gain Financial Independence and Create a Life of Freedom. Written by Dave Gow. Narrated by Dave Gow. Preface. By the way, I'm just sitting here recording this at home in Perth, Western Australia, so you may hear a few birds chirping outside. And if you hear anything else in the background, it's probably just my bulldog snoring on the couch. The images found in the print edition of this book are available as a PDF. You can download this file on the product page where you purchase this audiobook. Chapter 1. My Story and Introduction. Your present circumstances don't determine where you can go, they merely determine where you start. Nido Cubain. We don't want you here anymore. Those were the words my boss said to me on a warm spring day in the sheet metal factory where I worked. Those words shocked me, but for some reason I also felt calm. No stress, no panic. A wave of acceptance washed over me, and if I'm honest, even a dash of relief. Not because I was financially independent and didn't need to work, not even close. Let's set the scene. This was my first job as an adult, which I was getting fired from. I was renting with my friends and had bills to pay. I had zero investments and no other source of income. So why wasn't I stressed? Because I had one thing, savings. Enough to live on for 6 to 9 months, maybe a year if I stretched it out. And this wasn't a huge pile of cash either, we're talking $20,000. My job loss resulted in what I now call the summer of freedom. That summer meant the next 10 years of my life turned out very differently from the norm. I'll share that experience in a minute. But first, I want to take you back to a big decision I made at age 18 and how I later lost my job. My big decision. A few months after getting my license at age 18, I moved to Perth from country Victoria. Well, more specifically, a friend and I packed our bags, loaded the car with junk food, and embarked on a road trip. We drove to Perth in my mid-90s Holden Commodore. I arrived with about $800 in the bank. We had no jobs lined up, but we had a friend's place to stay at, and Perth's economy was on fire at the time. This is 2007, so we had zero concerns about finding work. Why did I move? Well, I was from a small town with limited prospects. I had no job, no qualifications, and very little money. Meanwhile, some friends had recently moved to Perth, and I kept hearing about the abundant jobs, the beautiful weather, and all the incredible places to see. I was sold. After all, I really had nothing to lose. Starting work. Within a week, I found a job. The work wasn't exciting, but I was learning something and working full-time, feeling like an adult. Most of all, I was getting paid. Being unskilled factory work, the pay wasn't high. Around $20 an hour. But seeing that money hit the bank account each week was like Christmas. Wow, this is awesome, I thought. The work became enjoyable and the people were good to work with. It did get extremely hot in summer though. I found it ironic that we were making air conditioning ducts inside a sweltering hot factory. I'd jokingly call it the sweatshop. Despite this, I found a comfortable groove. Over the next 12 months, I even started doing some overtime. Work was busy and the extra pay was nice. My savings were building up. At that point, I didn't have any financial goals, so plenty was spent on clothes, takeaway food, and nights out drinking. But then something changed. The changing work environment. Our manager left, and his replacement was, well, an asshole. He was a total dictator who wouldn't listen to reason. He made changes that everybody hated. He acted like he knew better than everyone else. And with him being a large, intimidating guy, nobody dared argue with him. Morale went down. People just accepted this new reality. Everyone kept plodding along, saying nothing, and doing what they were told. Once, the machine I was operating had some issues that needed fixing. When I made suggestions for repairing it, he said, "I don't give a shit about your opinion." Really? Who talks to their staff like that? Maybe it was the shock from that moment. Maybe it was the drop in morale. But something forced me to stop and think. Why do people put up with this? Why does nobody stand up to the boss? And if people were unhappy, Why wouldn't they leave? I started looking around at the other guys. But this time, I really looked. At their faces, demeanor, and body language. It was clear. They didn't want to be there. And now, neither did I. At the age of 19, I was starting to see the dark side of full-time work. My future flashed before me. Shuffling around this old, hot, sweaty factory in my 60s with that same despondent look on my face. Another soulless cog in the machine. That image terrified me. No way in hell. It became 100% clear in my mind that this future was unacceptable. No freedom and no choices. No thanks. There had to be another way. I just didn't know what it was. Yet. At the same time, I also became curious. Why do people stay in jobs and situations they despise? This sounds naive, but I was a teenager at the time. So I asked people why they stayed at this job. A few shrugged. Others said, I've got bills to pay. The common vibe was this pattern of work, spend, eat, sleep, repeat is an unavoidable reality. The downward spiral. My frustrations wouldn't go away. I don't want to be stuck working here for the rest of my life. I'd now seen the dark side of full-time work. Putting up with conditions, demands, and people we don't like in unsatisfying or meaningless jobs. All because we need the money to pay bills. Why does it have to be this way? All I could think was, man, wealthy people don't have to put up with stuff like this. After all, if you have enough money that you don't need to work, these problems disappear. You can do whatever you like, whenever you like. I started daydreaming about what it must be like to be wealthy. My attitude at work became worse. At first, going to work was enjoyable. Now it was a chore. I dreaded Mondays. And I resented having to work at all. My productivity collapsed. Mentally, I checked out and my care factor declined to zero. I'd happily roam around talking to people and taking extended toilet breaks. 1 hour was my record. Basically, I was milking it. Looking back, this was my way of reclaiming some control and rebelling against the bullshit. But the respect was gone. I couldn't take the workplace or my superiors seriously anymore. Without respect, the instructions and tasks are meaningless. And when things feel meaningless, your motivation disappears. Summer was coming up and work was getting busy again. Management asked us to do overtime every single day. I live by the beach, so I just want to hang out with my friends after work, I said. They didn't care and insisted on the overtime. I refused. A few unproductive weeks later, I was called into the office for a meeting. That's when I heard those fateful words. We don't want you here anymore. Management explained how I clearly didn't want to be at work. And it had reached the point where they didn't want me there either. So we signed the paperwork and parted ways. I said goodbye to a few people and walked out to my car, still in shock. Maybe it shouldn't have been a surprise. But driving home, I smiled, then laughed. This confused me at first. Shouldn't I be stressed out? After all, that's what people do when they lose their jobs, right? Why didn't I care? Then it dawned on me. I wasn't worried because I had savings. I wasn't going to become homeless tomorrow. I had time to figure things out. That's when I decided, this shall be the summer of freedom. Only I didn't have a cool name for it at the time. The summer of freedom. I spent the first few weeks of unemployment relaxing and hanging out with a mate who'd just moved over from Victoria and wasn't working yet. He had some money saved from a part-time job back home. Soon after, one of our housemates could see we were having a great time not working. So he also quit his job. At this point, we all sound like absolute bums. But each of us were living on our own modest savings, no government handouts. All up, I spent about 3 months relaxing, going to the beach and the gym, hanging out with mates, drinking, and just enjoying the freedom. It was a simple yet profound experience. To top it off, our house was basically a rundown mansion opposite the beach, with ocean views stretching out to the horizon. The rent was $700 a week, but between 4 or 5 people, that was manageable. And while this might sound like your average young adult's lazy summer, I did lots of thinking.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.